3, 2, 1.
Well, hello everybody. I hope you're excited for a fun class because I've just got a nice, easy class for you. This time, I'm just going to talk about only a few things, but these are going to be really, really, really useful things. As you know, if you've been taking these classes or watching them on YouTube, we've talked about a lot of stuff, a lot of good stuff. So we talked about choosing left-hand accompaniments to go with you and right-hand sounds and how to choose them and pick them out and how to, you know, use all the instrument goodies. And today I'm going to talk to you about your right hand and not just the sounds, but how to play the sounds. Because every sound you choose, there's a good way to play it and a not so good way to play it. So I'll talk a little bit about that. We got some musical tricks coming up. But first, I'll just start with a song. And then I think Robert might have some announcements after the song here. And then we'll get started with our class. So this song, let me actually show you, is one of my a song by one of my favorite singers of all time. And his name is Sam Cooke. I don't know if you recognize him. I think he died at a young age, but he has one of the best voices of all time. And if you get a chance to hear this song, it's called Cupid. So you can look it up after this, but I'll play my version of it that I just kind of made up on here. And I'm going to use our symphonic sounds in here. So it's going to sound like it's a symphony. So you'll hear strings and French horns. And here we go. Lost my microphone. Thank you. All right, I'm going to go back to Robert here. He's got a couple things he wants to mention.
Okie dokie. Just because I got to go rehearse for a little something, I'm going to just give you, you probably already saw this, but yesterday, I believe, I sent out an email, and it should have looked something like this. This is a blown up version of it. We are going to have member appreciation days, actually all month long, but we are dedicating a week just for all of our students. And basically, in short, we want to say thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You know, back in April when the world was changing, we basically had no clue what was going to happen to Fletcher Music Centers. And the reality is, we could say, you know, the staff members and myself, we did this and that and the other, but really none of this is possible without our customers and our students. Without you, we can't do this. So we want to dedicate an entire week to our students. And so we're going to have to kick off the week on Monday at 3 p.m. Eastern. So for you Arizona, that's 12. And if you're somewhere else, I'm just going to have to ask you to do the math. but we're going to have an opening day concert, a very special Zoom musical with Don Casanova from The Villages, Carrie Price from Port Charlotte, and of course, Joni Monero, who's on here. So you better be nice, because she'll do stuff to you. She found out how to do a virtual dunce cap now. You haven't done that yet? No. Okay. So we're going to have all three of these artists on Monday, and it's going to be hosted by John Riley, and he wants to get on and host the event and say thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And then all week long, and as the week progresses, I'll give you little updates and reminders, but we're going to do, this is exciting. On Wednesday, you'll see right here, it says a rare Zoom performance, the Joe Fontesha. He is going to be performing on an instrument that we've never, ever, ever had in the history of Fletcher Music Centers played on. And he's going to do an entire performance on this. And it's not going to be your typical time. It's going to be an evening performance, which means late afternoon for Arizona. So you're going to have to dim the lights in Arizona and pretend it's evening. but he's going to do an evening a performance. We'll keep you updated on that. And then our grand finale of the Member Appreciation Day week is going to be our very own students. We are going to have a student from each store play a song at our Zoom musical. We think it's going to be one of our most favorite Zoom musicals ever. So we get to spotlight our students. So that's happening next week. This Friday, we are still having our weekly Zoom musical. And we have none other than Mr. Dave Muth, who is only known mostly by folks in the Mesa area, which is where he resides. And I won't spend a lot of time now. Sean will tell you a little bit about him later. He worked closely with him throughout the years. And he is a talent in his own right. And he has a very special skill that and selection of songs that we typically you don't hear in a lot of our Zoom musicals. So it's going to be a treat to have him. And last but not least, next Wednesday and Thursday, write this down, and I'll type it in the chat before I go rehearse. Next Wednesday, Thursday's virtual variety class is going to feature learning how to memorize a song. I know I've been talking about it for a while. And so that next Wednesday and Thursday, there'll be the same class both days. I'm going to teach that class. We've had a lot of people that been asking when I was going to do it, and I've been telling him I'm going to do it. And I thought Wednesday and Thursday would be the best time to do it next week. So join in like you normally do. I'll get you the materials in advance, etc. I'll send you some reminders letting you know that, hey, it's going to be happening. So with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Sean Maloney, and he's got a fabulous class for you today. So it's all yours, Sean.
All right. So today I'm going to talk about musical tricks. There's just a couple of them. I'm going to start with, and you'll want to take notes throughout this because there's a lot of good stuff, and it's stuff that you'll want to look back on while you're playing songs of your own. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is called articulation. Articulation. And I'm going to give you a few different examples on how to articulate while you play your music. So this is a right hand technique that I'm going to teach you, and this is all about, depending on what sound you're using, how you play that instrument. And the goal is to make it sound as realistic as possible, because if you're playing certain instruments, you want it to sound like that real instrument, so people go, wow, that sounds real. You know, so if you play a trumpet and you don't play it like a trumpet, people think, oh, that sounds kind of weird. They don't know why, but they'll realize something's not right about that. So we'll talk about that. The first type of articulation we'll talk about is called staccato. You might have heard that word before at some point. And staccato, S-T-A-C-C-A-T-O, is just a way of playing a note. It'll be written in your song just like normal, but depending on the instrument you're using, you might want to play it staccato. Now let's see, I'm going to quiz you guys here. Can anybody tell me what that instrument is called? You can unmute yourself if you want to. Xylophone, that is a xylophone. Or actually, yesterday I got corrected, it's actually a marimba, but they're close enough. They're both in the same family. Can you guys tell me what family of instruments that would be?
Percussion.
Percussion, correct. It is percussion. It is a percussion instrument. So when you're playing a percussion instrument, what you want to do is play it staccato. So if you're playing something like a marimba, pretend you're actually, you know, using a mallet, which is what they would use to play those instruments. So when you hit the notes, you hit them quick and you let go. So for example here, let's do something with a marimba. We'll do Chinatown, My Chinatown. Does that make sense? I was just hitting it like you would actually hit a mallet. You can do some tricks with that. Look into your instrument. You might have a button that says repeat. Some of you may have heard of that. I'll kind of show you real quick what that does. If you want to play something like a percussion instrument, but you want to do that kind of, well, I guess, repeated sound or the trill sort of thing like this, all you have to do is turn on a button called repeat. So you can look for that in your instrument. It's different on all of them. Some of it's just a button right next to the sound. On this particular one, the journey I'm playing on today, it's in the feature menu. All I have to do is turn it on and I can keep playing it the same way. What I can do is strike each key that I want to, like I said, but then on some of them, I hold it down like this. So you can play it both ways. So that is how you would play staccato. That's just one example. And you can use that with several different types of instruments. It doesn't have to be just percussion instruments, but it's any time you want just a short, quick sound. You just tap the note and let go like it's really hot, like you're touching a stove when it's on. If it's not on, it's okay. All right, so next I'm going to talk about another type of articulation. This is number two. And this we're going to talk about playing. Well, actually, let me show you a picture first, and you can kind of guess here where I'm going with this one here. Tell me what instrument that is. Somebody.
Violin.
What's that?
Violin.
Violin. That is correct. Also called a fiddle. That is a violin, and that is in the string. That is in the string family. So when you're playing a stringed instrument, a lot of the time you may want to choose to play the notes legato. That's your next word. That's number two, legato. L-E-G-A-T-O. Backwards, that's otegel. All right. I don't know why I said that. I'm from Chicago. I remember seeing Harry Carey, do the Cubs announcer, and he would always, when a game gets really boring and it's just one of those slow games that just doesn't end, he'd start saying the players' names backwards. He'd You know, up pitching next is Ramirez. Backwards, that's Zarimer. All right, anyway, so legato is holding down the note and connecting each melody note on your right hand. So when you're looking at the page, don't let go in between. Just go from one note to the other. Okay, so it's smooth and connected. You can write that down if you want. Smooth and connected. So let's do kind of a ballad example. If you're going to play something like this, let's do this song, Memory from Cats. You might have heard that song before. I'm going to use a string section, and I'm going to play it legato. And you'll see why it sounds more powerful, because I'm just holding it down, each note. Here we go. And let's do this, because I set up another camera. I might as well use it. So that would be holding down the notes legato, smooth and connected. It sounds very pretty. If I play that staccato, if I play that wrong, if I play it with short notes, it's not going to sound great. It doesn't have the same energy as a string section would. You want it to sound like a real string section, so play it legato. So hold that down. So that's our second example of articulation. You can use that with string sections. You can use that type with vocals, like choirs. Anything that sounds very rich and big, you want to use legato. You can use it with sax and brass sections as well, but you kind of want to steer away from it too much, because the next thing I'm going to talk about here. So tell me what instrument. Here's our next pop quiz. What in the world is that?
A trumpet.
Trumpet, yes. That is a trumpet. And that is in the brass family.
Sean Maloney, this is our third
type of... Somebody's thing is talking to me. This is the third type of articulation. And this, you can call it a lot of different things. Most people call it, I've heard, detaché or detached. D-E-T-A-C-H-E. Detaché. All that means is let the person breathe. So if you're playing something that you blow through, like a trumpet or a saxophone or a tuba, whoever's playing that in real life, since they're human, they have to breathe. Most of us do that. So when you have to take a breath between your notes, you need to put a little space in there. So if you're playing something like a trumpet sound on your right hand, who's a popular trumpet player? Does anybody have an example? Did I hear Louis Armstrong? There we go. Perfect. Louis Armstrong. He is one of my favorite trumpet players. I'll use him as an example here. Let's pull up our Dixieland style and play with Louis Armstrong. And what's going to happen is you're going to hear the wrong way to do it first. I'm going to play it with all the notes kind of connected, sort of legato. And just listen to this here. This is the not right way, because what you want to think about while you're listening to this, think about breathing and pretend you're the one playing the trumpet. So as long as I'm holding down a note, make sure you hold your breath, okay? Here we go. Thank you. So keep in mind, you gotta let the guy breathe. I tried to hold my breath that whole time and I couldn't do it. And that's what's gonna make it sound realistic, is if you take a little pause between the notes. So take a moment to breathe. So while you're playing that, you may want to sound a little bit more like this. Here's a better example. So this is letting the trumpet player breathe. There we go. Much better, right? I let the players breathe. So you want to play some notes if it's anything you breathe during. If it's a saxophone, trumpet, even a vocal sound sometimes, if you have the shooby-doobies, those are people. They need to breathe too. So put some space between those notes and it'll sound really, really authentic. So any questions about anything I've talked about so far? Any questions or answers? Anybody in the back? Okay.
I don't see any question marks or hands raised.
Well, I'm going to assume that's a good thing, hopefully, and not that people are sleeping, but all right.
No, you're teaching so well they don't have questions.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. All right, so next topic here I'm going to talk about is something called syncopation. This is another musical term that's going to add some flavor to your music here. And it's really, really simple to do. All you gotta do is play the song wrong. Okay, so syncopation, that's S-Y-N-C-O-P-A-T-I-O-N, syncopation. So all it means is playing the melody notes slightly off the beat. So you have your regular beat, 1, 2, 3, 4. If you throw the notes slightly off of those on the right hand, you play the same notes that are written. So in your music, you play the same notes on the right hand, but you throw them just a little bit off the beat. Here's an example. Let's look at this. Here's the song we sent out, just in case you want to try this on your own. That'll kind of be your homework. But this is a song called Mac the Knife. You may have heard of that before. What's kind of neat is, or what's funny, I should say, is that this music is kind of not good. If you play through this the way it's written, you see there aren't any rests, and all these notes are kind of on the beat there. If I play it as written like that, it'll sound fine, but it won't sound realistic here. So let's play this song real quick. I'm just going to leave it up on the screen, actually. And you can kind of follow along. This is me playing it as it's written there. Let's try it. Not that fun, because it feels very robotic, doesn't it? Every note you hit, it's right on the beat. It's very simple. What's better is actually to kind of play it the way Bobby Darin would have sung it, right? He's the most famous version of it. I'm going to try something different here. Hopefully this works. My internet, like we always say, is still kind of slow, so it might be a little blurry. But let's try this and see if this works. I'm going to show you a video clip here. And this is Bobby Darin actually singing the song. And pay attention to how different it sounds than what I just played, which is what was written. Here's Bobby Darin singing it.
Ooh, the shark bait has such teeth, yeah, and it shows them pearly white. Just a jackknife has old Maggie, babe, and it keeps it out of sight. You know that shark bites with his teeth, dear. Scarlet billows start to spread. But fancy gloves, though, where's old Maggie Heath, babe? So there's never, never a trace of red. On the sidewalk, ooh, Sunday morning, lies about day, just losing life.
Eee! That's great. So what's fun about that is, hopefully you noticed, that sounds nothing like what I just played, and I was playing what was in the music. So what he does is, you can hear him, he throws those notes slightly off the beat, so it kind of keeps you interested, and you can see his body kind of moving with it too. He's doing stuff like that. So think about it like that, like you're playing, but you're also riding on a roller coaster, so and it's a little bumpy. So if you throw the notes off the beat, it's going to sound a lot more real, like the way somebody would sing it. So syncopation is just kind of playing it like you'd sing it. Throw the melody a little bit off the beat. Now, I have a question. What is my left hand going to be doing throughout this? What do I change? Nothing. I see somebody going like that. That's good. You do nothing. Your left hand stays the same. Your left hand you play on the beat. So if it says play C for two measures, well, you play C for two measures. And then when it changes to D minor, you touch D minor on the beat. So all you're changing is that right hand part. You're throwing it off a little bit. So I'm going to play the song here. I'll just play it throughout. And listen to how much better this sounds than that first way. This is what you can do at home. And it's really easy. Like I said, all you do is just play it wrong. So look at the notes. Don't necessarily pay attention to 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. Don't worry about that. Play it the way you hear it. Just make sure your left hand's on point there. So here, let me change to this here so you can see it a little better. And let's play Bobby Darin's Mack the Knife the way he would like it. Thank you. You didn't hear me, but I said, look out, old Mackie's back. I just had the microphone off. So, all right, so that's Mack the Knife, the way Bobby Darin would have liked it. So what you can do for your homework here, your homework assignment, is to kind of look at that song. You should all have it now. Let me do this here, and you'll have it in the email. And it looks like that. So what you'll want to do is play through that and kind of throw the notes off the beat a little bit. And if you noticed, I had this question the other day as well, I played these songs a little bit differently here and there as well, using some of the articulation techniques I told you about. So I played a couple notes legato, where I held it out a little bit longer. I took a couple and I played them staccato, and I threw them off the beat a little bit. So when you're playing through this song, give that a try. This is an easy song. Anybody should be able to give that a try there. Don't worry about some of these, you know, you'll see eighth notes and, you know, dotted quarter notes, and just play it the way you hear it, okay? And if you're like some of our students, they like, you know, some specific extra things. If you want to, I can give you some stuff here. If you want to play some of these like this, you can, any minor chord in the song, this will sound nice. If you want to, and if you don't, then don't. But if you want to, you can put a 7 on any minor chord in here. So any of these ones that have an M after it, if you want to make it a little more colorful, add what's called a 7. In this measure here, this is for you technical people here. If you want to get specific here, you can do this chord. Sounds a little more colorful as well, right there. You can play what's written and it'll sound plenty good, but this will just give you, if you're the type that wants some extra chords, because we got some of those in here, you can add 7s to the minor chords. Like I said, any minor chord, put a 7 on it. If you want to, at this point in the song, do a C diminished 7. And I had that question the other day, what is a C diminished 7? What notes are in that? Well, I'll tell you, if you want to play it. And like I said, if you don't want to play it, don't. That's okay. You don't have to. But if you want to play a C diminished 7, you'll do a C, E flat, G flat, and A. C, E flat, G flat, A. And it gives it kind of a suspenseful sound, like, ooh, where is he going next? So just adds a little bit of color. So let's see. Another example. I'll just give another quick example because I did the other day. I might as well do that again. If you don't like that song, maybe you want to play a different song, try that with any Frank Sinatra song. Any Frank Sinatra song, because he was the king of syncopation. If you listen to some of his live stuff especially, you'll hear him throwing the notes all over the place where it almost sounds unrecognizable. But he's great at that. He throws the notes all over the place, like the writer, whoever wrote the song, would be like, what is that? So if you play any Frank Sinatra song, try that as well. Here's Come Fly With Me. Let's try that real quick. I'll play it wrong first, and then I'll play it the good way with syncopation. Yuck. It sounds way too robotic, way too robotic. So let's take those same exact notes that are written and let's throw them around a little bit. Let's toss them up in the air and put them back down. Here, let's do it the better way. Thank you. That is the way Frank Sinatra would have liked it, if you kind of throw the notes around a little bit. So anybody can do this. It's not something that I'm saying, you know, you got to be a good player to be able to figure this out. Just play the notes a little bit off, and it'll sound 1,000 times better. So any questions about syncopation, anything to do with syncopation or articulation? Those are the topics I talked about today. So any questions at all? How do I do that on this? How do I do that with that? Anything like that?
I don't see any hands raised.
Wow, so quiet today. Oh, good. Rich, save me. What do you got?
Question. Let me unmute myself. Wait.
Oh, you're unmuted. I can hear you.
Oh, I thought I didn't think I unmuted myself. When you talked about changing a minor chord to a seventh and a diminished to a seventh, is that universally true? Will it make it richer in all cases?
I think so, with as far as minor chords. Okay. If it's any minor chord, I'm just a nerd like that, and I like to add a 7 just to add a little bit of color, because it'll make people think I'm better, you know?
Yeah, because I know Joe Pantecchio gave a class. He was talking about changing basic chords to sevenths and what have you.
Sure.
Get a richer sound.
Sure. Yeah, any type of minor chord. Ooh. Any type of minor chord, you can put a 7 on it, and it'll just add a little bit of color. It won't completely change the song, but it'll give you a little bit of color. At diminished, you don't want to add to all of them. That's just in that specific song. I just think it sounds a little better with that one.
Okay, thanks a lot.
So, yeah, don't go doing that, because then it'll sound bad if you put diminished all over the place.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, good question. Any other questions before I mention a couple things coming up? And like I said, that's your homework, okay? Try using some of those things we talked about today in any song. You know, you could use a Frank Sinatra song. We sent out a song as an example. You can use that one. That's a good one to practice with. So otherwise, just a couple things coming up. I will mention we are this Friday. We have one of my absolute favorite people in the world doing a concert, and he'll be right here in Mesa. That's where I'm teaching out of today. His name's David Muth, and he's actually here today. He's here practicing and getting ready for it. So he's kind of on the other side of the store, so I won't bug him, but he is so excited to play for you guys. He has a degree in organ playing music. He is a true professional. He's toured all over Chicago and Arizona. He's played professionally with comedians. You know, a lot of the time they have like an opening act or a support musical act. He would play with people like Henny Youngman, George Gobel. So they'd do a comedy set, and he'd play music along with them. He's fantastic, so please, please don't miss him. Otherwise, another thing, let me see if I can bring this up on the screen here. Give me just a second. We are pretty much done here with our website. We have a FletcherMusic.com website now. And let me share the screen, and I'll show you what it looks like. Because what we're going to do over time is we're going to start going toward the website more than sending emails all the time. We'll still send you update emails, let you know what's going on. And for now, we're going to keep doing what we've been doing. But maybe in the next month or so, we're going to try to make it so you can access every single class, every single activity from our website. So right now on our website, I have FletcherMusic.com. And I clicked on this button that says classes and events. And in this list here, ooh, look at all this. You got a calendar for all of our variety classes that we do. And it tells you on the right side what's coming up next. So if you went on the website and clicked on this, there you go. It's got it right there. So you just click on the link from here. You don't even have to check your email. And if you want to come to our product feature classes we've been doing, for example, we have an SE series class that is 1 p.m. on the 14th, and it's listed right on the right side here. If you want to go by date, they're on the left side, and you can click on it there as well. And it tells you exactly what instruments they're for, and if you click on the link there, it'll take you right to the class. So you just go in it that day. And then down on the bottom here, special events. This is where we put our Zoom concerts. So Friday, you can test this out tomorrow. If you want to, go to our website, go to the classes and events, and then click on tomorrow's event there, and you just click the link to join. Easy enough, right? So in the future, what we're going to be doing as well is specific events for our stores, our store locations. So we have up here locations, and you can click Arizona stores, Florida stores. If I am in Tucson, I would click Tucson, and then I can see what event I have coming up for that store. Like, for example, next Tuesday, they have a Song of the Month that they're doing specifically for Tucson. However, maybe you are in Sun City Center, Florida. Maybe you want to check that class out too. You still can. You can go to any class you want. So if you click on these different locations, you can see what all the individual stores are doing as well. So that's just a little bit about the website. Give you some idea how to use it. Explore it. Test it out on your own. Just go to FletcherMusic.com and check it out. And you can click on stuff, get used to it, because we're going to start using it more and more. So that's, I think, all I had to mention there. Helen, do you have a question there? I see your hand raised.
Yes. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
How do we get materials?
Materials, they're still probably going to be emailed out for now. We are eventually going to have the materials on the website as well. But for now, we're probably still going to be emailing them out once a week.
Okay.
Well, actually, for now, we're still going to be doing exactly what we're doing. And we'll let you know when it gets a little closer. Probably sometime in October, we'll start sending less emails and saying, go to our website to get this. Click on this link on our website. So just experiment with using it for now so we can you can kind of get acclimated, and then we'll move closer and closer to that together.
About today's materials?
Today's materials you got in your email today. All I talked about today was that song, Mac the Knife. I don't have materials for the things. That's why I said write it down. The articulation and syncopation.
Okay.
So if you write those two words down, you'll be good.
Thanks.
And then just rewatch the video on YouTube if you need to. What's that, Joni?
David has a question.
Yeah, David, go ahead.
I do. Mm-hmm. I think I'm unmuted. Can you hear me?
Yep, I hear you.
Okay.
And what do you know? I see you, too. Oh, now you're muted. Click the unmute button again there. There we go. Okay, I think somebody's muting him.
I'm not.
Okay, I'll click unmute one more time there, David, and it should let you talk. Okay.
Okay.
There you are.
There we go. If you miss a class, can you go back through the website to pick up a class that you have missed? And if so, how?
If you miss a class, that is what our YouTube channel is for, our YouTube channel. So youtube.com/FletcherMusicCenters. And I think we do have a link to that on the website as well, so you can get to that from there too. But YouTube is where it hosts all of our recorded videos. So that's where you want to go to find anything that you might have missed. If it's something that's upcoming, then that's what the website calendars are for as well.
Great.
Cool. All right.
Thank you very much.
John.
You're welcome.
John.
Somebody say my name. Yes, yes.
Here, Joe Apicella. Do you know where we could get the music to the Coast Guard? I play a tribute to America. I start out with Taps. I think Joni did one. I usually play two versions of Taps and then Elvis Presley's trilogy and then all the military songs. But I just can't pick up the Coast Guard song. I have a problem with it. Is that available anywhere?
I'm sure you can find it somewhere. I really don't know. I don't have it with me. You can contact actually somebody from our store here in Mesa if you want to. I see my other helper saying, I've got the music. So if you want to contact our store here, you can. You can write this number down if you want to. It is 480-830-3959. And ask for Bart. He's got the music.
Ask for who?
Bart, B-A-R-T. Backwards, that's Trab. Okay, Jerry, you got a question?
Yeah, I just wanted to say about that music. Try musicnotes.com. I can find almost anything I want on that website.
There we go. Could do that too. So, yeah, so contact your local store or go to musicnotes.com or talk to Bart here. He's at my store here. We got a ton of music here. So I'm going to finish up here and play a song on our way out. So thanks, everybody, for your attention, and I hope you got something out of today and give you something to play around with. So here's a song. I'm going to play some country music because I want to. This song is called I Fall Two Pieces, and it's originally by Patsy Cline. What I like is I really like finding good rhythms to go with. What's that? I didn't catch that. What you can do...
Country, great.
Oh, you're welcome. Oh, hey, Maureen. If Maureen likes classical music, our guy David Muth here was going to play. He was telling me what he's going to play. He's actually going to play a really, really nice classical tune as well. So don't miss the concert Friday.
That's
okay.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah. So I Fall to Pieces. What I'm going to do with this is use a background rhythm that's kind of surprising to some. I'm going to use the Spots of Ink rhythm. And that's a rhythm based on the Ink Spots, who did a lot of 1940s gospel style music. And the reason I'm using that is when Patsy Cline originally recorded I Fall to Pieces, she actually used a gospel group called the Jordanaires. And this actually sounds very similar. So you're going to hear a doo-wop group playing with Patsy Cline. So this is kind of cool. Here we go. Thank you, everyone, for joining me today. I hope you got something out of today's class, and have a great rest of your day. So thanks again. Oops, pressed the wrong button there. All right.
Thank you very much. Good job.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Good job, son.
Thanks, Sean. Good stuff.
See you later, John. Sean.
Thank you. Have a great rest of your day. We'll see you tomorrow at the concert.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Sean.
All right. Have a good one.
Thanks, Sean. Bye-bye.